Good evening and welcome to the LCC speaker series. No, I don't always speak like this. I just happen to have a case of laryngitis. And no, I haven't been cheering the fact that everyone's come tonight and seems so excited about it. Although, if I could cheer, I would. Thank you very much for coming. This is the third in the series of LCC speakers. What I'd like to announce tonight is that we're so encouraged and enthused by the response that we guarantee that there will be a second season of LCC speakers, and we would like to invite each and every one of you to return tonight a copy of the little program that you got, and all you need to do is either leave your name at the entrance or to leave one of the panels on this sheet of paper, and we'll be certain to send you out a list of all the speakers in the series. As you, most of you know, this is the third in a series of speakers, and we're very proud here at Lower Canada College to have introduced into public debate and discussion here in Montreal a caliber of speakers which I think has brought more and more people out. We began the series with Anne Dowsett Johnston, who has earned a tremendous reputation across Canada as the editor of the Maclean's Guide to Canadian Universities. And we followed up 2 weeks ago with Dr. Thomas Lacona, who is the most well-regarded and highly recognized proponent of moral education in our schools. And we've topped it all off with one of our own, Dr. Lou Marinoff, who graduated from LCC in 1968. And we're so proud to have Lou, and particularly excited about the fact that he's generated tremendous excitement, not only here in our community, but in a large segment of the Montreal community. I've been asked by the organizing committee to simply remind you that if you'd like the highlights of this address tonight, they are available at a cost of $15, and you can sign up at the end of this evening to receive them. And we know from our past experience that some of these speakers deserve to be witnessed again, and I think you'll really enjoy it. It's a tremendous pleasure for me to introduce one of our faculty members who teaches philosophy. He's a man that we respect greatly here at Lower Canada College, one of our finest academic teachers, our grade 11 academic supervisor, our philosophy teacher in grade 12 in our pre-U program, Mr. John Vlogianis. Please welcome him.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bennett. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Dr. Marinoff grew up in Montreal and, as you just heard, is a graduate of Lower Canada College, class of 1968. He went on to finish an undergraduate degree at Concordia University, a BSc in mathematical physics. From there, a Commonwealth scholar, it was off to University College London, where he completed his PhD in philosophy of science. He is currently a philosophy professor at City College of New York. He previously held a fellowship at Hebrew University of Jerusalem, and also spent 3 years teaching at the University of British Columbia. Dr. Marinoff has been described as a pioneer, and I think it's very accurate, of the North American philosophical practice movement, which is now two decades old. He's founding president of the American Philosophical Practitioners Association and a former executive director of the American Society for Philosophy, Counseling, and Psychotherapy. He's the author, as you well know, of Plato Not Prozac, Applying Philosophy to Everyday Problems. And at last count, the book is being translated into 15 languages. Dr. Marinoff has been featured in articles in the New York Times, the San Francisco Examiner, the Philadelphia Inquirer, the Times of London, and most recently the Montreal Gazette, and that, of course, is not an exhaustive list by any stretch of the imagination. As someone who enjoys the privilege of introducing philosophy to the young people in our pre-university program, I'm very proud tonight to introduce a man who is committed to reminding all of us that philosophy, far from being simply another esoteric pursuit exclusive to specialists, possesses a relevance to human beings which is unique and an often neglected power to illuminate and to heal. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Lou Marinoff.
Thank you very much indeed, John and Dr. Bennett, headmaster, affiliates of Lower Canada College, and ladies and gentlemen, this is the salutation of a speech that I really dare not make here. This for me is somewhat of a homecoming. I look around and see in the gathered audience immediate family members and students with whom I studied at Lower Canada College some 30 years ago and perhaps more. I see other friends, dear friends from the Montreal community, and so it looks to me more like a homecoming than a speech. If I went home and dared to make a speech at the supper table, I would probably hear about it. So I'm going to talk to you as though I were at home, and from the perspective that it's a great pleasure to be home. The speech that I will nonetheless make in the context of talking to you is one that I've had an opportunity to make now in quite a few places, cities, countries, and so forth, in the wake of something that seems quite simple on the face of it, but which actually leads to unending complexities in terms of its manifestation as partly a cultural revolution, partly a philosophical renaissance, and indeed a movement, as it has been called, which has political and cultural and educational implications, most of which are going to be far too vast for me to discuss at any length with you tonight. I'm given, I think, some 45 minutes to talk, and then to entertain perhaps questions and comments from you for a like time, after which we will move downstairs or wherever the books are, and I'll be delighted to sign any copies that you may wish me to sign. That's basically the agenda for this evening. So let me really begin, I guess, at the beginning and resolve some fundamental issues with you. This quite informally. Again, I don't mean here to give a very esoteric talk. I want to make it quite plain to you, and I will await to be challenged by you with more esoteric questions during the allotted time. Right now, I just want to speak to you as plainly as I can about what this is, perhaps what it isn't, how it came to be, and where it's going, this thing called philosophical practice. My premise is simply that philosophy in the ancient world, and I mean here the ancient Hellenic civilization, as well as the civilization in the Indus that gave rise to the forest sages of India, as well as the civilization in ancient China that spawned philosophical consultants such as Confucius and Lao Tzu, philosophy in these three contemporaneous ancient worlds was really about the art of living. It was not an esoteric, scary, inaccessible subject, which it has become, particularly in the last century in our universities. So given that philosophy was once a way of life, when people now ask, well, how is philosophy becoming useful to people, in an amazed tone, my response is normally, well, how did it ever cease to become useful to people? And this is partly an historical question, but one which is not too difficult to answer. The advancement of science in particular, gave us a lot of knowledge about the natural world and a lot of optimism that such knowledge could be extended to make the social and political worlds somehow better places. This in some ways succeeded and does succeed, and in other ways, of course, it failed lamentably. And so there was a kind of backlash against science, which has led some people back into religious fundamentalism. But Bertrand Russell most accurately remarked in the earlier part of the last century, that philosophy occupied a position in a kind of no man's land, caught in a crossfire between religion and science. And indeed, in the 20th century, as science advanced and religion somewhat retreated, philosophy sort of abdicated the field altogether and endeavored to make itself as irrelevant as it could possibly be, and largely succeeded, one might add. Henri Poincaré, the fine French mathematician, apocryphally once toasted pure mathematics. He said, "Here's to pure mathematics. May it never be useful for anything." And one can well understand his point. However, the fact that there are people who indulge in pure mathematics and find it both a wonderful and rewarding mode of mentation does not belie or abrogate the fact that we need applied mathematics to do virtually everything else, be it engineering, be it statistics, and so forth. So the fact that theoretical mathematics thrives does not de-necessitate applied mathematics. On the contrary, it gives applied mathematicians more tools with which to discover things that are useful in the application of this subject to the world. In fact, physics is very largely the language of mathematics applied to the world. And so it is with philosophy. And analytic philosophy, by and large, by its very nature, and continental philosophy, by and large, by its very abstraction, has, in this century past, removed itself from everyday life. I encounter, in my travels these days and engagements, lots of very well-educated people. Probably some of you number among this sort. People who, notwithstanding first-rate educations, managed to avoid taking philosophy classes altogether, perhaps did take them and were disappointed at their inapplicability to their own lives. Some of you are nodding already. Or perhaps did take them and then nodded off to sleep because they weren't being treated to a relevant exposition of ideas. So this is no one's fault. That's just the way things move at times. And so long as we were willing to accept that the human being can be modeled really by two points, two endpoints of a straight line, one being biological and the other psychological, and as long as we were willing to remain in this very linear model, we didn't need philosophy. It turned out, however, that experience has taught us otherwise. So I come to you as someone who had no intention of ever doing this, and actually had no foreknowledge that I would be doing it, but nonetheless I'm very glad to be. So I want to deliver to you a message of optimism and also of serendipity, because most of what's happened to me in the last 3 years and to my colleagues in this movement, both in the United States and Canada and internationally, has been very largely serendipitous. And I think that is the best way for things to happen. So I thought philosophy was useful to be really applied to my own life, and so I did apply it as a kind of guinea pig, but never had any intention of using it on anyone else, either as a therapeutic modality or with the hubris or the chutzpah to suppose that I actually knew something more than they did or was wiser in any way or could help them in any way. It turned out empirically that people can be helped by this, and I'm very glad to be in the service of providing that help. You see, it goes back in a way to LCC also. Our motto here is non nobis solum, which means not for ourselves alone. There was a great deal I could say philosophically about this motto, but I won't. Suffice to say that it's not a slogan. A slogan, of course, is something that one normally employs for political ends in order to excite the passions in some way or other. But a motto is rather something that gives us pause to think. And to unpack it is really to embark on a philosophical journey in understanding the mission of the institution that employs it. We were privileged to attend LCC, and I think that the people who attend it today consider themselves equally privileged. Our society, and particularly now I speak of America, has unfortunately tended to confuse right with privilege lately, as well as engage in other dangerous confusions such as offense with harm and so forth. Of these I will say a bit more later. But the idea that we should do things not for ourselves alone is precisely the idea of philosophical practice. Because the theoreticians in the academy, and I am one of them with sort of one foot in the theoretical tradition, I too publish incomprehensible papers. I enjoy it, moreover. And I'm even paid for it, in part. This is not a problem. There is a mountainous accumulation of theoretical knowledge. The academy has blossomed in the last few centuries and has produced an exponentially increasing number of journals which add crumbs to this mountain of knowledge. The question that one might ask if one were, say, in the frame of mind of Aldous Huxley is, how does one put the pieces together? How can one possibly attempt a synthesis? How is it possible for us to know so much and yet to understand so little about ourselves and our presence in the world? And thus, we find an accumulation of knowledge that really begs in some way to be applied. The theoretical philosophers do it for themselves alone, and they, and I as part of them, form a community that really has no mandate or no interest in interacting with anybody else. We are in some sense cloistered. And this, I think, is an unfortunate development in the sense that it needs to be complemented by a movement outside. There have to be people to take philosophy outside the ivory tower and bring it back to humankind as a way of life. Because people themselves have realized, and in America, believe me, everything is market-driven. If anything is, everything is. And it is the market forces themselves which have asked that philosophy be returned to them, and that our linear model, in fact, be now unfolded, and we find that it is not at all a question of the human being being compassed by two points, one of which is biological, the other psychological. There is now a triangle that emerges, and the third vertex is the life of mind, the noesis, mentation, the philosophical life. And to a certain extent, what we believe, of course, has profound influences upon what we choose to do in the world and the way in which we are perceived. There are interactions with psychology and philosophy, as well as interactions with biology and philosophy. But to neglect that vertex, to neglect questions in life that pertain to ethics, value, meaning, purpose, and so forth, is to neglect the very thing that makes us human beings, as opposed to potted plants or pigeons in Skinner boxes. It's only water. All right, let me just clear up a couple of preliminary points. I've already met some of you in the anteroom, and you've already asked extremely good questions, perspicuous questions, which I can't possibly answer in 5 minutes, but you've given me pause to think that you're very engaged with this movement already, and I want to try to anticipate some of what many of you may be wondering and address that in this part of the presentation. Before doing this, I need to clear up a couple of preliminary points. Some of you have asked me this, specifically my friends, what is this business with Lou? My name is Louis, and I've always been known in Montreal, and indeed in Canada as Louis, and suddenly I have a populist identity, this Lou. What are they to call me? Well, look, here you can call me what you like. Home is a place where they call you what they like to call you. Louis is the name I respond to. You must understand that in the United States, we undergo a kind of cultural transmutation. This name does not, it's not received as L-O-U-I-S. It becomes Louis if it's spelled this way. And that quickly degenerates into L-E-W-I-S, and then it becomes cognate with Jerry Lewis. Not that there's anything wrong with Jerry Lewis. basically, this is the direction that Lewis takes down there, so I quickly learned to avoid it. If one wishes to be called Louis south of the border, then the spelling becomes L-O-U-I-E, you see, and this is more cognate with someone who operates a tricky garage in Brooklyn, who is a, perhaps a third-rate mafioso. If he were first-rate, it would be Luigi. So I cannot countenance Louis in any of its forms, because Americanized, it loses its entire significance for me. I discovered, however, that given that the extent to which the U.S. is a monosyllabic culture, Lou works just fine. People like Lou Grant are regarded as reasonably avuncular authority figures who can sort of carry on some responsibility and not be misnamed every time someone addresses them. So I've adopted Lou, and that's what it is. And this is what's on the book. All right, so that settles the nomenclature, but not the authorship. This is a separate question. I didn't really write this book, although it has what isn't really my name on it. It runs deeper than this. I didn't really write it. That is to say, I dictated it, which is all right. But HarperCollins here had the perspicacity to understand how to market this thing. I didn't, surely. People say they love the cover. I love it, so I had nothing to do with it. This is the genius of the woman who acquired the rights to it, who's no longer at HarperCollins. Joel Doborgo did a wonderful thing. In really conceiving a vision of what this was. We have the raw materials. Philosophers are always long on materials. Some of us have, in recent history, been very short on personability and marketing and interpersonal skills and all those other things. But HarperCollins did a magnificent job with the book. You may also wonder why is this popular at all, and I will endeavor to account for this in a philosophical way a little bit later. I have at least one or two hypotheses to treat you to, which I think may adequately explain why this is going worldwide at the moment, even into places where Prozac hasn't yet gone, by the way. I mean, we understand well enough why it goes where Prozac goes. It took a little more effort to understand why it's going where Prozac hasn't gone. I became a philosophical counselor completely by accident. I was working at the University of British Columbia in the Center for Applied Ethics. Now, you know that applied ethics is itself a growth industry and is indeed an important bridge between, again, academic philosophy and the so-called real world or the extra academic world. applied ethicists, if I may say so, without sounding too critical, tend to be more reactive than proactive. That is, they're people who are very well schooled in the professional ethics of a number of areas, including the medical profession, engineering, computer science. There are even books on legal ethics and journalism ethics, believe it or not. They're very thin. and moreover, no one reads them, but there are ethicists who specialize in these fields. And business ethics is not an oxymoron, as a matter of fact. Well, not necessarily. It certainly can be made into one. But actually, it's quite conceivable that virtuous organizations are much more functional in many important respects than our vicious ones. And that doesn't mean that they're less profitable either. So you see that applied ethics goes a long way already to taking philosophy into large-scale professions, not speaking to any persons necessarily, but in speaking to spheres of interest that are fundamental and operative within our ethos. But by the same token, applied ethicists tend to be, again, I'm not being critical, merely making a prejudiced observation, tend to be reactive in that they wait for some catastrophe to unfold and then have a conference, you know, about it. Publish the proceedings and make contributions to journals. Well, this is what scholars do. Scholars are ghouls in one sense. They're not rank opportunists the way that ambulance chasers are, or some politicians who turn up only at catastrophic events seeking somehow to be voted for. But basically, this does happen in applied ethics. I was working there not because I was an applied ethicist either, actually, but because I knew something about computers and could speak French. Now, this makes sense in Canada, you see, because given that this was a federally funded project in the University of British Columbia, it was very important that someone speak French out there, although no one else did. And also, since these philosophers in the early 90s were actually getting very high tech, some of them even had email. I mean, in the 90s, you know, the scientists had email for a decade, the government and military people for a similar amount of time. The humanities wing was just beginning to discover it and was beginning to produce, no doubt, long and somewhat rambling dissertations on the advisability of using email or not, even though one had never used it. But we used it, we liked it, and it worked. So then a funny thing happened. Because the media, again, this word media, and I digress, if some of you are here because of the Montreal Gazette, you will know that I have continued my studies in New York, although I am indeed a professor of philosophy there. I still learn as much as I possibly can, and one of the things that I have come to learn down there is a subject I suppose one could call media engineering. So of that perhaps more later or less. But the media in British Columbia didn't need engineering from us. All the applied ethicists there were on their Rolodexes. And whenever something happened, in BC, you know, there's more of a focus on environmental ethics. People there chain themselves to trees regularly. But they have legitimate environmental concerns. We in the East, having long since paved everything over, don't share those. But they do. And there are biomedical issues which are pertinent to them as well as us and so forth. Hardly a week or a month went by when there wasn't an important applied ethics issue in the news, and so the media people phoned the center to solicit, you know, the mandatory soundbite from the resident professional ethicist. And our secretary at the center was very good at referring the media people to the appropriate specialist. But then a funny thing happened, you see, entirely unlooked for. The public at large, this is going back to about 1991, evidently began to realize that there was a group of fairly objective, you know, reasonably dispassionate and not uncompassionate philosophers in residence at the university who were willing to actually make pronouncements about things, be they ridiculous or not. We were willing to get up and say what we thought was the case and defend it with some view from a tradition that spans 2,500 years of careful argumentation. I call it the world's second oldest profession. And when they did discover this, they actually came forward looking for help for their personal problems. This was the beginning of philosophical counseling for me and for some of my colleagues. People actually started phoning the center saying, I want to talk to a philosopher. Some people actually walked in off the street demanding to see a philosopher. Can you imagine how desperate they must have been? But it was also clear on a serious note that there was a need not being met. And so we began to meet it. The secretary at the center became very adept at screening these calls and at doing what we would now call intake. I developed some protocols and said, look, if we're going to see people, and we're not charging for this, we didn't even have a mandate to see anyone, let alone to recover, you know, costs for doing this. We just saw people. And we tried to match up the appropriate problem with the appropriate philosopher. To make a long story short, that put me in touch with the movement, what I'm calling the movement. I later co-organized the first international conference on philosophical counseling at the University of British Columbia in 1994, along with an Israeli colleague who had gone everywhere through Europe and other places and America, had met most of the leading practitioners, and somehow sized me up as a likely person to be able to lay on a conference logistically. We then had a very successful international event, and that was the launch, if you like, of philosophical practice worldwide. We were, for the first time, cognizant of one another, practitioners from Germany and Holland and Israel and America and Canada and Finland and Norway and other places who had not hitherto known about one another, came together under one roof and began to realize that we had the makings of a movement. We were so enthralled with ourselves after 94, we did nothing in 95. In 96, the Dutch laid one on, which was very good. They cloistered us. They wouldn't let the media near us. We did some really good philosophical practice with each other. In 97, I organized one in Manhattan, having moved to New York to take up a position at City College. And that was what provided the impetus for all the rest. I simply organized a conference, and I will tell you the truth before coming to what you're really here, I assume, to hear about, namely the nuts and bolts of philosophical practice. I just must tell you, though, how serendipitous this all has been. I organized a conference and sought only to bring in a gate in order to defray the costs of the people who had come from all over the world, because they wanted to be in New York, but also because they wanted to come to the third conference. We managed to get one piece of post-conference publicity, and that turned out to be reported in a newspaper I had never heard of, but I was a newcomer to New York, and in my innocence and ignorance, I didn't know that of the 200 press releases that the university PR office had faxed off. I wrote them, of course, there was no one else to do it, but the university PR office faxed them to their hit list, and you must know that university letterheads are the kiss of death on press releases. They come out of the fax machine and go straight into the file, the permanent file. Now, this one person who came covered the conference for a publication which circulates only, and I say by Manhattan standards, only 275 or 180,000 people, but actually, as it turns out, to all the people who make the culture. This was the New York Observer, and to my horror, actually, the week after the conference, I saw a feature in the Observer which had a huge picture of me, a small picture of Freud, a small picture of Socrates, and the caption, Plato or Prozac. And that was in August of 1997, and my phone has not stopped ringing since. This is really what precipitated, because the New York media, of course, is the international media, and once they got hold of this, and it turned out that there was a need in America, perhaps even a bigger need in America, for the moral aspects of the educational service we provide. This need is now our obligation to meet. And that has been, from the beginning, the difficulty that we have faced. It's not a question of selling ourselves, or even marketing ourselves, or hawking our wares, or being shameless hucksters. And this is what one is in America, typically. It's a way of life down there. And it's not unenjoyable. But really, the serious issue for us has been to meet the demand. We've understood that this is the challenge. And we are doing, I say we, my colleagues and I in the APPA, are doing our level best to meet this. All right, I also, before going on now to the nuts and bolts of this, just want to thank, again, by way of my being at home, a couple of people who have helped me a great deal. My mother is here tonight, and would you mind, Ma, standing up and taking a bow? She's been a constant friend and supporter, as well as a mother, and I'm very privileged to be able to introduce her to you. And actually, my son is here too, somewhere. Julian, who is also an old boy, a younger old boy, 30 years after me, has been an enormous help in philosophical practice. He's worked with me in building the organization and in doing a lot of things, and he's also given me some very good advice from time to time, and I'm grateful for his help too. Son, are you around? Please stand up and be recognized. Thank you. Tremendous help. All right. So what do we do, actually? As I've indicated, the successes of science, and particularly the social sciences, trying to emulate the physical ones, we call it physics envy, that they allegedly suffer from. They have, in Browning's words, one could argue that their reach has exceeded their grasp in many areas. What we have witnessed, particularly in America, again, with the impetus of enormous amounts of money and profit, put behind and to be realized from, respectively, the drug trade, that is the licit trade in drugs, The war on drugs was lost a long time ago, and I'm sure there's much more profit there, but the illicit drug trade is very big business indeed. So good, in fact, so lucrative that Eli Lilly has not sued me or HarperCollins for using their trademark Prozac. They don't care. In fact, we're probably selling more Prozac for them at this moment. And sometimes I feel like I need some myself on these tours. But actually, people are treated as a hangover from, in some sense, the excesses of the medicalization of the human condition. People are treated as ill. Life is not a disease. If I had a bumper sticker for this movement, this is what it would say. Life is not a disease. We are born and we grow and we die, and what goes on in the interim is very largely what we make of it. And bereft of a philosophy of life, or bereft of an articulated philosophy of life, or what Socrates called the examined life, then we are as likely to be conned by someone whose interests we do not understand, that life is a disease, as we are to have the leisure or the good fortune to experience life otherwise, and then to understand that there is another tradition which endeavors to explain to us what it is to understand, what it is to do a good thing, what it is to understand rightness or justice or meaning or purpose, and what it is to not fear, to lead the examined life, which doesn't always lead to immediate comfort. As John Stuart Mill finally said, better to be a human being dissatisfied than a pig satisfied. Better to be Socrates dissatisfied than a human being satisfied. That isn't to say that we need to seek dissatisfaction as a revelation of meaning, but that sometimes the price one pays for understanding is certainly discontent. But this is also not illness, surely. This also does not mean that philosophy seeks to replace medical science. On the contrary, there are people who definitely need psychiatric incarceration to prevent them from doing harm to others. This is consistent with Mill's harm principle. And the press here does us something of a disservice within the service of propounding the movement. They do sometimes engage, you may have noticed, in controversy and in scandal. It's very easy for them to misrepresent what we do and to elicit rather intemperate remarks from leaders of the American Psychological Association or the American Psychiatric Association. Look, the LA Times had on its front page a couple of years ago a statement by the then president of the American Psychiatric Association, who alleged that I was practicing medicine without a license because I gave ethics counseling. So one can understand the incredible arrogance and hubris of this pronouncement. In fact, legally he's correct. As a licensed physician in the state of California, he can do what he likes pretty much with talk therapy. I can't. The laws, the counseling laws in California are so egregious that if you took a friend to lunch and had a heart-to-heart talk with her, and this, I'm telling you, it's the truth, and your friend then said to you, thank you, I feel much better, you could be indicted for a misdemeanor. That is practicing counseling without a license. The psychologists have been quick to monopolize conversation in spite of the First Amendment. Psychiatrists have been very quick to disregard any sort of ethicity or axiology, that is, theory of values, that the human being is capable of espousing. So my standard riposte to this kind of charge doesn't do anything to resolve the debate or make it more comprehensible. It's just a sort of give and take that the media wants, in which inevitably we have to give them. Or they move on, you know, to Mike Tyson or whatever it is they are covering that day. But basically, my reply is sort of twofold to this kind of charge. Firstly, if the psychiatrist thinks that ethics counselor, the people who have ethical problems are mentally ill, then he needs philosophical counseling. That's the first point to be made. And the second one, which is a much more serious one, and that has to be made in the political arena as well as in the legislative one, is that, in fact, if he is prescribing medications or other kinds of psychiatric interventions to people with ethical problems, then he is practicing non-medicine with a license. And this seems very clear to many people. Why it is not clear to many practicing counselors, I do not know. So this is basically a ground of confrontation, but in fact, we know better, and so do most people who practice. And there are many psychiatrists who have now joined the APPA, about which I guess a little more later, as well as psychologists and people in other counseling dispensing professions who are not philosophers, who recognize, indeed, if they're honest and open and thoughtful, that they do encounter ranges of problems every day, almost, some of which are not at all medical or legal or psychological, which are indeed philosophical. And then what we're saying is the same thing as what they are saying, namely that the best care that one can offer is appropriate care. If a client comes to me and his or her problem does not lie within my scope of practice, I am not trained to diagnose so-called mental illness. I am trained as a critical philosopher to wonder how much in the DSM-4 is reified and how much is real. But aside from that, I'm not trained to diagnose mental illness or mental illness, whichever form you prefer. I am trained to understand what a philosophical problem is. And if someone comes to me with a problem that isn't, then I obviously would refer the person for what seems to be the most appropriate help. And one would expect the professionals who are advocates of their clients in other areas to do exactly the same thing. There's also an informal test you can take. I call it the New York subway test. I ride the New York subway when psychologists who are terrified of what we're doing or psychiatrists who are indignant about it say, but they aren't trained to recognize dangerous or suicidal people. We say, right, ride the New York subway. You all have some very long standing evolutionary gifts, some of which include the ability to recognize dangerous or threatening or aberrant behavior according to whatever norms you practice. And if you're sitting on the subway, the question is very simple. If someone comes on the subway car and sits next to you and is clearly acting in a manner that is not in keeping with the prescribed conventions of your ethos, then you know perfectly well that you feel something that either makes you worried or scared or indeed causes you to move to the next car. And that very same thing would cause us to refer such a person for appropriate care if such a person came to see us. You see, this is basically common sense. What do we do then? What kinds of problems are philosophical? All kinds. I guess an illustration here is germane, although the book is full of them. I'll just give you one. It's the one that usually provokes yet more controversy, so I don't mind giving it to you. If there's anyone here who's terribly politically correct, then you should be seated near the exit for this. But it's not that bad. It deals with the case of a writer who had a very good job indeed and was quite happy as a writer. His problem was that he had put up a Gauguin painting in his cubicle, and another colleague of his took offense at this and compelled him, through mechanisms which I think unfortunately are in place now in the workplace, to take the painting down. That is, his choice was to take the painting down or to be fired. That is, to hand in his letter of resignation. Well, he did what we Americans would call, you know, the pragmatic thing. He took the painting down. But he found himself very upset by it. About 2 or 3 days later, he found, in fact, an increased sense of outrage, anger, frustration, and so forth. And he sought philosophical counseling. This was probably a wise thing to do. I use this, and as much as I've just told you, I tell to groups of psychologists and psychiatrists and ask them then what their diagnosis would be. This is basically what I was confronted with as a narrative. Then they roll up their sleeves and they say, well, we have lots of work to do. Psychiatrists can find 5 or 10 things in the DSM-4 that are wrong with this guy. And psychologists, of course, can go to work on his emotions. I'm not belittling these disciplines. I'm merely pointing out that in this case, those, in my opinion at least, those interventions are irrelevant. His problem was one of injustice. It's a philosophical problem. There's nothing to be found in his childhood. There's nothing to be found in his biochemistry, which addresses what he is feeling that is wrong. And what he needs to recover from this is a sense of justice. How can he recover a sense of justice from this and then get on with his life? That's really the issue for a philosopher. Even our detractors will, I think, grant that justice is an issue that one or two philosophers have addressed. So the way in which one works in this case is to find an interpretation of what has happened from which this person can derive either, at the worst, some kind of solace, but preferably a change of frame of mind. Yes, achieve what I call a philosophical disposition or contemplative position from which the incident is no longer disturbing. And this is not hypnosis. This is not done with smoke and mirrors, and it's not psychology. It's very simply recognizing that some circumstances can be very much bettered or worsened according to the way that we choose to look at them. And that, of course, one presupposes that one is free to choose. This is another philosophical question, and I leave it to you. If you're a fatalist, you'll have none of this. You'll tell me that he was fated to see me, I was fated to tell him certain things, he was fated to feel either better or worse. I can only give you Isaac Singer's standard riposte, and this also proves nothing, but it's at least amusing. Isaac Singer says whenever he's crossing the street with a fatalist, he notices the fatalist waits for the light to change. Of course, the fatalist will simply say that he was fated to wait for the light to change. But I am with a number of philosophers on this issue who merely declare that the will is free and there's an end on it. If we don't have that, we don't have much. And because the will is free, we're free to choose a disposition. There have been people in history who have not been philosophers who would have had the common sense to find their own dispositions. And I'll give you a quick example of one such case. Pablo Casals, again, something that that I cite in the book. Casals broke his arm skiing once and had to cancel 3 months' worth of concerts and had to do all kinds of, you know, logistically difficult things. And he came out for a press conference. Casals, the great cellist, suddenly confronted with the prospect of not being able to play. He was beaming. He was radiant, joyous. The press were disappointed, of course. They expected him to need, I presume, psychiatric help for this, or possibly Prozac. They asked him why he was so happy. He replied, because now I don't have to practice. So is this the old story, you know, about the cup being half full or half empty? Of course it is. And who decides whether the cup is half full or half empty? Not the cup, surely. You. You. And when your problem is more complicated, it does not mean that you are incapable of finding and adopting a disposition that will at least shed the most profitable light on it for you. And I am enough of a deconstructionist, although I'm not really one, but in this case, it seems that there are many ways in which one can interpret a given situation. So I'm not going to suppose there are many ways in which one can add 1 + 1. I believe that the distinction between fact and value is factual, not a value-based distinction. But when it comes to interpreting a narrative or interpreting a situation, even when one is faced with a biological fact of some kind, in this case that one's arm is in a cast, I'm not supposing that pretending it isn't will make it not so. Nor am I going to lapse into inconsequential solipsism and suppose that nothing can happen to my body because I probably don't really have one. That's not the kind of disposition that's useful. This is the Cartesian road, too. And you should know, Descartes, we can use Descartes in counseling, but he's generally not very good. I think, therefore, I am. This does not produce much social engagement, you will have noticed. It's more accurate, I think, to observe that we are thought of, and therefore we are. We are also social beings. And also we think of how we present ourselves to others. If we're careful, we do at times. And this produces a whole matrix of interaction and a whole nexus on which we can exert causal influence, granted that we have some range for volition. And if this is so, then it makes a good deal of sense to try to understand what you believe about a certain thing, because what you believe about a certain thing may not change the thing itself, but may change the circumstances in which the thing itself unfolds. And you may derive great satisfaction from finding a philosophy of life that works for you. So what about our poor friend who took the painting down and kept his job and was really miserable? Note that he didn't go back, you know, with an AK-47 and shoot the office up, as we say in the States, go postal. I think this is the syndrome that's defined by the media. He didn't do that. Some people do that. And more disturbingly, some children do that. That brings me to a very serious part of the talk suddenly. I am concerned about the absolute dearth of any kind of moral guidance in particularly American schools, and I will come on to say a little bit why in a very few minutes. But if we cannot rescue a comprehensible, a transmissible, and a practicable kind of moral instruction from all that we have experienced in this process of civilization, then we will have failed, regardless of how long we extend life expectancy, regardless of our other technological achievements. These are, in some sense, nothing compared to the value of leading a decent life and of allowing others to do so as well. That's a purely political sentiment, perhaps, but one I'm not ashamed to espouse and defend. So what we do as philosophical practitioners, it should be clear, is render an educational service, not a psychological one and not a medical one. But it is the want of an educational service that has left people floundering desperately in the last 30 years and has left children to resort to expressing commonplace rejections with mass murder. This is absolutely unconscionable. What we have failed to do is to provide them with any sort of barrier between what is thinkable and what is doable. Anything is thinkable, but not everything should be doable. And it is there we need to intrude and make plain that, of course, anything is thinkable. Try to think an unthinkable thought. You will not succeed. But it is not the case that we should be able to act on anything that we can think simply because it's possible for us to do it. That, of course, is the moral compass, which is, at this point, vacillating all over and nowhere. So what we did with this fellow philosophically is to cause him to become aware of John Stuart Mill's distinction between offense and harm. You know, Mill said basically in his famous essay on liberty that, and he argued quite compellingly, that the only warrant that the state has for coercing or restraining an individual is to prevent that person from harming others. his own actions, his own tastes, even though we deem them perverse, are none of our business to interfere with. So he then understood that there was a policy in place which made this leap and considered that because someone took offense, that person had therefore been harmed, which was not the case, I would argue. We also take offense, you see, or not take it, as we are able, as we have some sense of moral worthiness, we're not obliged to take offense, even at things that are aimed offensively at us, and this wasn't. Go ahead, try and offend me. Try it. You may succeed, but it won't be easy for you. I've practiced not being offended. It's a very good thing not to be offended. You know, the French army, among many others, practiced the duel. And the practice of the duel was outlawed in France only when more officers were dying in duels than in combat, and there was a fear that there'd be nobody left to lead the troops. This is how easily some people were offended to the point of mortality. It's not necessary to be. In fact, people who need to take offense and who are rewarded for it, moreover, this becomes behavioristic. When in America, huge amounts of money are paid to people for taking offense, what you expect that you're conditioning them to do, to be more reasonable? Surely not. The other. So he understood, fine, the system in some sense had confused offense with harm, and this person could easily have complimented his taste in art rather than been offended at it. If someone harms you, you are not an accomplice. If someone offends you, you have taken offense. You have been offered offense and you have taken it. And if you can cultivate a sense of moral worthiness, and we have tools for this too. But if you can do that, you need not take it. This he understood. But it did very little good. That is, it only brought him halfway home to understand that somehow this injustice that he was experiencing in an uncomfortable way was really systemic. This is not an apology for injustice. It's an identification of a kind of injustice. But to say that it is merely systemic does not make it less unjust for him, does not make it more palatable. One could easily say that, you know, slavery was a systemic injustice or genocide was a systemic injustice. That doesn't make it less unjust, clearly. So the thing in this case was to turn it around and say, you know, you yourself have been offended by the system by being compelled to take your painting down, but you weren't harmed by it. Ah, then there's a little breakthrough. And he says, yes, I can adopt John Stuart Mill's philosophy and not take the offense. And then we do a little social judo. You see, there's always something else. I suggested that he go back with a list of paintings that he wouldn't mind substituting for the Gauguin, the offending Gauguin, and that he ask his colleagues in the office, which one would you not object to, you see? And then everyone can be happy. And he can do this as facetiously as he likes without offending them. And recuperate a measure of vengeance if that is what he wants to do, and I don't recommend it, it doesn't work very well. But if he really needs to do that too, he can do it in such a subtle way that no one will ever know. And therefore he can remain blameless. He can have his cake and eat it too, in other words. This is possible for philosophers. By the way, as a professional counseling modality, this required one session. There was no couch, there was no long history. And it's a nice clean case, so obviously I'd like to cite it. We also work with groups and with individuals. Someone has to tell me when I have 5 minutes left or something, okay? Because I am a philosopher, it's very, very difficult for me to be brief. You understand this? So I need a high sign from someone, okay? Please, thank you, John, when I have 5 minutes left. We work not only with individuals. This is the thing the press has got hold of. And this is the thing that they can manufacture controversy from. But it's also the thing that we're making the deepest political inroads with at the moment. There is in New York State at the moment legislation pending to certify us as professionals. And I am working as hard as I can with a confluence of very benevolent and somewhat powerful forces to establish eventually a PhD program in philosophical practice. See, we need to graduate practitioners. Right now we're doing a stopgap thing and training and certifying them all over the world, all over the US. We're getting all sorts of requests from philosophers, not only because they can't find work, that's the worst reason to do this, but actually because they have studied philosophy because they love philosophy. And they don't mind loving philosophy and tending bar or driving taxis, but it seems a frightful waste at the same time since they didn't need to study philosophy to tend bar or drive taxis. And now there's an opportunity for them, some of them, to learn other ways of applying philosophy. This is where the pioneering comes in. We figured out how to do it, and we do it. But others are quite capable of doing it if they're given just a little bit of guidance. The form of the professional interaction is really what needs to be explained. The content is up to them. We don't tell them which philosophers to use or which not to use. That's up to them. If you come to me with a problem that looks Heideggerian, I will refer you to a Heideggerian. I don't I don't mess much with the Dasein analyse, but I know people who do, and they can do Heideggerian philosophy with you. If you come to me with a problem that looks like it might be managed by Hegel, I know a Hegelian as well. You see, this is the art. We do what we like. I like Chinese philosophy. That's one of the things I like. That's one of the things I pretend to know something about. And so I work with people in this way. And there is something really very interesting about it. So I'll tell you, why is this happening now? Why is philosophical counseling and philosophical practice in general becoming so important? Because the philosophy degree itself was worthless at one time. It had become basically the most debased credential in terms of its impracticality that the academy could offer. People, on the one hand, were very admiring of philosophers as some sort of holy fools or sort of pathetic creatures who were condemned to think for a lifetime. But really, if your family was anything like mine, then you were expected to be a doctor, a lawyer, a chartered accountant, do something useful, clearly. A philosopher, we have trouble here. What's he going to do for a living, you know? Well, guess what? We're doing philosophy for a living. And our organization, the APPA, now gets calls every day. We get email and faxes and phone calls from all across the United States and Canada and around the world from people who don't have philosophy degrees, who say, what can I do to get certified by you as a philosophical counselor? And we say, MA in philosophy, and they're going back for it. A lot of them are going back for it. Suddenly, a degree in philosophy is becoming valuable. Why is this? Well, Chinese metaphysics explain this. The thing is that one presupposition we have, of course, in the Tao, is that everything contains something of its opposite. So you see, if a philosophy degree were really that worthless, then it would have to have been the case that it contained something of incredible value too. And then it's just a matter of time, the unfolding of the cosmos and the confluence of propitious forces to make that worth manifest. But it was never not there. It was simply unmanifest, if you pardon the mysticism. We work with groups, and you may have heard that there are philosophers' cafes and philosophers' forums that are mushrooming all over Europe and North America. Why are we doing this? Again, there's a need. The globalized culture, which is also partly a tabloid culture, has succeeded in alienating an intelligentsia. Why are you here tonight? Why aren't you watching primetime television? Well, when this becomes primetime television, you'll have to go somewhere else, clearly. But at the moment, I suspect it's because you find this interesting or stimulating or unusual, or simply that it may satisfy some of your noetic needs, of the mind, noetic needs, which are not elsewhere being met. This we find in our philosophers' cafes. They're completely informal. People come in and want to discuss things philosophically. Our culture is so far gone in some respects that this becomes newsworthy. The very fact that people are assembled in a public place exchanging ideas brings in the cameras. This becomes news. People are thinking, look at this. They come in with TV cameras, with radio microphones. They want to record every thought. They try and catch everything in a big net, and then, of course, dumb it down and reduce it to a 15-second soundbite. And we represent a challenge to them. They're trying to dumb us down. We're resisting. Now, this book, I did not write it, as I say, but it was very cleverly marketed so that it would reach a large audience. I'm not capable of reaching that audience because I write in a way which is comprehensible to me on a good day and to a few others, perhaps. But even when I think I'm writing for, you know, the man on the Clapham omnibus, the intelligent layperson, and no, I'm not. I'm really writing for some other academic. So I had a lot of help, and the ideal collaborator for this book was Colleen Kapklein. What did she do? She was a person who also, as an intelligent, well-educated, bright young editor, had never taken a philosophy course in university and had never, more unusually, been to any kind of a counselor. So if I could explain philosophical counseling to somebody who knew nothing about philosophy and nothing about counseling, then presumably I could explain it to anybody. And this is basically one of the reasons why the book is going into, I guess, so many tongues, because we succeeded in that experiment. We also work with organizations. And we work formally with groups, too, I should just mention. The informal thing in the cafes gets attention, again, because it's newsworthy. But we do a very serious thing called Socratic dialogue, wherein a small group of people gets to actually be philosophers for a while, instead of just studying other people's thoughts. Schopenhauer criticized that as the difference between mere automata and human beings, people who merely bandy about other people's thoughts and then formulate their own based on their like or dislike of others' thoughts, or for Schopenhauer, automata. People who think for themselves, essentially, are human beings. And we are, in this sense, midwives. We subscribe, most of us who do this practice, subscribe to Plato's notion that you are all pregnant with wisdom. The philosopher does not tell you anything you don't know. The philosopher knows how to conduct a general inquiry. Socrates was being almost disingenuous in a way in order to lull his interlocutors when he said to them, I don't know anything at all. Of course, he knew something. He knew how to get them to contradict themselves. This is some kind of knowledge after all. And more intricately, in the Theaetetus, Plato lays out a very beautiful schema whereby one can actually play this noetic midwife and bring from people an understanding. If I ask you the question, what is liberty, or what is happiness, or what is justice, or what is integrity, you might not be able to tell me in so many words, but the idea is if you have had such an experience, you know what it is, you need some help in articulating, in making explicit what is implicit in your understanding. That is the role of the midwife. It takes 2 days. It takes 3 weeks in Germany, 2 days in Holland. Our challenge is to make it take 2 hours in Manhattan, and we're working on it. But it's a very beautiful method. And incidentally, even the two-day thing, with recourse to your own experiences only, a small group, when led through this process, developed by Leonard Nelson, using some theories of Plato and Kant, will allow people to arrive at a concrete and comprehensible answer to such universal questions. And another ambition of the APPA is really to make a one-weekend Socratic dialogue mandatory somewhere in 4 years of liberal arts education. You would hope there would be time for this kind of a weekend. There's time for every other kind of a weekend, I don't have to tell you. But this kind of a weekend would be very good. And this is another thing that we're striving to do by way of education. Yes, we work with corporations, and we work with boards, with CEOs, with teams, at all sorts of levels. I'm a general practitioner, and so I'm dabbling now in counseling, in group facilitation, and in corporate consulting. I find it interesting, so I try to spread myself way too thin. But some people specialize and do so very well. My colleague Tom Morris, for example, famously, I guess, if Aristotle ran General Motors, works only with corporate culture. Why is this now becoming important? And this is really the summation. To me, it answers this question about philosophical practice, and perhaps I'll stop on this note. When people ask, why is it? If I were a pessimist, and I'm not very good at being one, I would say yes, because our civilization is in decline, and people are grasping at the last straw, and the last straw is philosophy, and after that, you know, there will be nothing, and we will sink back into some kind of existential abyss. I don't believe that for a second. I think that really what is happening is that there's a kind of slate being wiped clean, and what we are seeing is not the downfall of Western civilization at all, which I would not be happy to see, and which I will fight to maintain if necessary, but we are seeing its metamorphosis into a global culture, and we need to retain the best of it. And the global culture is economic, and this they let me teach today to some students. I'm amazed that I was invited not only for lunch, but also to come in and talk to students at LCC. Well, this is a Rubicon I thought I would never cross. But they didn't let me whack any, though. I mean, we used to get whacked, and we deserved it, too, at times. And I was kind of hoping they'd invite me back for old time's sake, let me give them a lecture in ethics and then give someone three of the best to make an example. This is usually how we reinforced sound thinking in my day. Not anymore, alas. Times change. But seriously, what I told them, I'll tell you in perhaps the 5 minutes that remain before I throw it open to your observations, comments, and questions, is simply this, that we witnessed in the 17th century a revolution in thought led by people like Bacon and Hobbes. And the principal idea that Hobbes expressed in the Leviathan was that politics must not be a branch of theology. This was quite revolutionary, and it took another 150 years for people to figure out how to put that into practice. And then later in the 18th century, we had two revolutions based on that premise, that really politics could not be a branch of any theocratic state or theocratically enslaved ancien regime. Fine, understood, point taken. Then what happens? Well, then, with politics hived off from theology, it became possible for the human being to ordain the state instead of the state ordaining the human being. And this was, in some respect, what enabled unprejudicial or at least minimal prejudicial scientific progress to take place and all of that. We got rid of the dogmas, some of them. We found new ones. But we made some attempts at progress. We tried other things which failed. But we basically have separated in what we would call the developed world politics from theology starting then. But something else has happened, because in that separation one still saw different economic systems subservient to given political ethos, and one did not see anything else until recently with Marshall McLuhan's conception of the global village in the 60s, with Buckminster Fuller's conception of spaceship Earth, and with all of the other empirical stuff that's happened since, not to mention the revolution in computing, the internet, cyberspace. We have transcended, in a truly Hegelian sense, politics, and now we're witnessing the second metamorphosis, and that is the separation of economics from politics. Economics is no longer a branch of politics, and this is what we call globalization. This means you can go to a different country and pull money out of an ATM, or as Americans love to call them, ATM machines. Nothing like language is a blunt instrument. In any case, you can get money from your ATM machine, and you can circle around the block till you find a parking place, and then, fine. Don't get me started. I love language, you see, but, and it has meaning, too, sometimes. The point is that you can actually bypass political systems. You can bypass nationalized political banking systems in this case. And this is the combination of electronics and globalization. So basically, political borders can be transcended. This is very good. And it is, I think, the raison d'etre for the emergence of philosophical practice. Why? In a word, it's very simple. And not to be cynical about this, in my book, I do tell you, I really believe that at least organized religions gave people moral instruction. That's one thing you could count on. Any religion worth its salt is going to give you probably more moral instruction than you care to have, but at least you're going to get some. Perhaps more is better. You know, too much is better than too little in this case. Passé Aristotle's golden mean. On the other hand, they wanted your soul. And this, not everyone was willing to relinquish. Not everyone was willing to admit that they had one. I mean, this is an open question for some of us, you know. So how can I make a bargain to give you my soul in exchange for your moral instruction if I don't know I have a soul? This would be dishonest of me in some way, and therefore not countenanceable. Religions function by faith, philosophers function by doubt. This lets us off the hook. But it doesn't solve the problem. When political systems then hived off, they wanted something. They don't want your soul, they want your vote. And they will do whatever they have to do. This, of course, led Churchill to condemn democratic politics as the worst form of government, except for all the rest. We understand this. All right? They want your vote. But they still give you ideology. They give you quasi-moral instruction. It becomes politicized in a certain way, and it becomes camouflaged. And sometimes it becomes aberrated through politicization. We have Orwell and other people to remind us of this. But it's a kind of moral instruction, all right? That serves the state. It's patriotic moral instruction. It's a little bit dangerous. It's about mammon. It's about monolith. It's about the city of man and not the city of God. But they really just want your vote, and this you can give. But what do the corporations want? They're running the world now. They've transcended politics. I think it's a good thing, because then we can have, if we need, you know, to harness or to constrain some bully who has behind him the resources of a state to marshal in the name of aggression, what can we do? We don't have to bomb necessarily. We don't have to invade necessarily. We can try economic sanction. This could be very powerful. I'm just suggesting that there are other forces can be brought to bear that are in a rational world going to be more convincing than will coercion. But they're not moral forces either, because what they want is your dollar. I mean, you know, right? The church wants your soul, and the political party wants your vote, and ultimately the corporation wants your dollar. But this is where we come in, because them wanting your dollar makes no comment at all upon their moral standing. It doesn't mean that they're moral or immoral. In fact, most of them are amoral. And they're quite willing to contemplate the proposition that a virtuous organization is more functional than a vicious one, and not necessarily less profitable. And the human beings who have moved from being mechanized cogs in a Newtonian machine to fragmented, perhaps soulless beings in an amorphous worldwide structure, more than ever need to recover a sense of meaning and purpose and dignity and justice and all of those things in the world. And the companies that are basically employing them and giving them perhaps a better life than other people have had since the human first appeared, and the people who plan and run and manage those structures are as much in need of philosophical practice as anyone. So this is the opportunity in front of us, and you are seeing basically just the thin end of the wedge. You're seeing the spearhead of what may be a movement. Some people say, well, isn't this just another fad? And we say, yes, of course, it's a 2,500-year-old fad. And I'm happy to offer it in some way, shape, or form to you tonight. Thank you very much for your indulgence, and thanks to LCC for laying on the event.
Thank you very much. We will entertain questions, and please use the microphones on the side, because we're recording the questions as well. And don't be shy. Come up and ask a question. Use the mics on the side if you could, though, please.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
I just wanted your thoughts about here in the province of Quebec, you know, schools divided along, divided along religious lines.
Could you speak up, please?
Our school system was divided along religious lines, and now they just broke it down into language, English and French, the school boards. And I just wanted your thoughts on...
Well, I'm going to duck this one. I'll give you the evasive political answer. My book is available in the French language, and I'll be very happy to sign copies. La traduction est magnifique grâce à l'édition logique. Et au francophone, je serai demain au Radio-Canada entre 11h et 11h45. Je crois que je suis fier d'être Québécois aussi, et j'aime beaucoup d'être un peu bilingue. Okay, I don't want to get embroiled in local politics. I've been out of the province for 15 years, and I would be very, very foolish to make any kind of political pronouncement.
Not really politically. It's not really a political question. Just morally, what would that do? Would you have any thoughts on that in the future? Like, would our society be better off?
Dividing school boards?
Dividing the school boards along language instead of religion.
Religiously based school systems, like the separate Catholic centered school systems.
They're now being divided by language?
Yes, they're linguistic boards.
Well, this would simply, in a very prima facie way, it would go toward the argument that we're seeing, again, a manifestation of separation of church and state, that the lines are redrawn on secular linguistic grounds as opposed to religious orientations. And this is just a kind of thing that's been going on for a very long time in other places, and maybe it was overdue here. I'm really not sure. What do you think about it?
Well, I mean, I think I'm against it.
You're against it? Why?
Yeah. Just think, just like you were saying, I believe there's a lot of morality that's being missed, not being taught in the schools. And, you know, a lot of events are happening worldwide. Well, I mean North America anyways.
Yes, but...
I don't know, that's not happening in the States. I mean, probably in the States.
The secularization of morality, if this is your point, then I think I do have an answer for you. The secularization of the school system is the best thing that could ever happen for moral instruction, in the sense that one can possibly manage to salvage the more important moral precepts and yet divorce them from any supernatural presuppositions. They can be embodied as viable ways in which one can be guided in one's actions without necessarily entailing subscription to mythological or supernatural beings, unless one wishes to subscribe to them. The problem in the States, and I can speak more, you know, plainly to that, is that the secularization of education has resulted in the disintegration of any kind of moral. There is none, basically. There's nothing. There isn't even civics anymore. People don't even understand. You see, this is, we have, fortunately at LCC, you are under the guidance of an historian who has an appreciation of these issues. But we have, in the United States, the notion, I think, that, you know, happy people have no history. This is a Nietzschean idea, you see. Happy people have no history. So let's not know anything, but it doesn't mean that those who don't know anything are happy. This is the problem. We're dealing with students who are, in a sense, in a timeless, spaceless, ahistorical present. Their reality is the shopping mall. They don't know where they come from, they don't know where they're going, and it's not really possible for them to understand, many of them, the consequences of their actions, because they have no context for understanding action. This is a generalization, but not a hasty one. So the secularization of education leaves a door open for someone to step in and say, look, it's fine to separate these two things, but if you're going to give people a decent education, you've got to engage their capacities for moral reasoning. You've got to give them some ethical context in which they can frame their behaviors. And you've got to lay down the law and say certain behaviors are not acceptable. And in the States, you have this double standard now where parents are being held responsible, that is indeed criminally responsible, for the actions of their children, and yet they're not allowed to discipline them, because the kids will phone an 800 number and, you know, report the parents. So how can we possibly function when the secularization of the state means that it intrudes itself on the family and basically succeeds in rending that nucleus apart? Then we're in real trouble.
Mr. Marinoff, you began your talk by saying that it was optimism and serendipity that brought you in that subject. Well, serendipity is finding something useful without looking for it. I feel that opportunity usually favors a man who prepares for it, to quote Pasteur. And I feel that our civilization has been ready for that sort of thing. Why did it take so long for your practice philosophy to take root?
Fair enough. I like your definition of serendipity very much, so I'll tell you a secret. Actually, it's a little more complicated than this. I did strive to do this, but was only able to succeed when I stopped striving. So I think that there is a time for strife and there's a time not to strive. The second part of the question is much more difficult. Why now? This is ultimately also a philosophical question. Why now? Why not yesterday? We had people practicing in 1981. Gerd Achenbach in Germany hung out a shingle and called himself a philosophical counselor. Not only did he not garner political support, he did succeed in establishing a very viable subculture of philosophical counselors, but owing to the recent political moves in the Bundestag against the Scientologists, and some of you may have followed this debate and understood that the anti-fascism to which the current German government is predisposed now begins to manifest as another kind of fascism, in that they've criminalized the auditing that the Scientologists do. Don't get me wrong, I've had my brush with American Scientologists. I really think they are a cult, and I don't mean that in any evil way either. They do what they do. As Hobbes said, you know, religions are basically cults that are publicly accepted. If you follow this, that's fine. But the Germans had no way of not being included in this broad brush legislation that, in the act of criminalizing Scientology's auditing, also inadvertently criminalized philosophical counseling. So there one can answer your question. There they had a chance perhaps to do more over a longer period of time because they didn't take political initiatives. They were accidentally marginalized in a very serious way. Now, I'll tell you this much. It seems to me as a North American that we benefit, particularly in the United States, from a lack of an ancien régime. That very business of the separation of church and state was done very brutally in France. And you know, I usually tell my students that, and this you know, may help you in the future to determine whether you want to engage me as a teacher or not, that in the French Revolution, they probably erred on the side of cutting off too many heads, whereas in the British Civil War, I think they didn't cut off enough. But basically, what one ends up with, you know, is this, that in America there is no ancien regime and therefore no old world prejudices against doing philosophical counseling or philosophical practice. So it couldn't happen in a really momentous way worldwide unless it happened in America. And America has a history of professionalizing things, for better or worse. This is what Americans do very well. I can say this as a resident alien. The emphasis is on alien. We commodify and we professionalize very well. And so the medical profession is also been taken to, you know, that kind of level in America, and then others emulated it. And this is what we're doing with philosophical practice. It couldn't happen in Germany or Israel or Norway or Holland. The Dutch tried to professionalize. Ironically, they've been practicing since the mid-80s, and they're very fine practitioners over there. You know, they have government agencies as clients, but the government won't recognize them by the same token. In America, people are much more naive, in a way, more gullible in a way, less imbued with prejudice. They're more like Tocqueville portrayed them. And they're quite willing to take something on its face and say, hey, if this helps in some way, if this looks like it's useful, I'll accept it. And the universities, as you know, have been so politicized. And just about anything has now become acceptable, particularly if it's antithetical to reason, that now they're willing to accept philosophical practice. Not because it's necessarily viewed as good, but because they've tried everything else. And it hasn't particularly worked. So all of these things play into it. But I'll tell you a little secret, okay? I actually, when I arrived in New York, tried very hard to get published. I had a little novel that I wrote before leaving Canada. It was my farewell gift to Canada, in a way. It's slightly politically incorrect. And I self-published it, and it actually sold very well underground. It has been used on several university campuses as an antidote to political correctness. But I tried to sell it in New York, and I actually played postman and went around to 150 literary agencies myself to meet people as I was trying to intrude and to be an opportunist in the way that you perhaps alluded to. And I met with very little success. People were astounded to see what I was trying to do, but no one bit at all. And so, fine, I wasn't particularly attached to this, you understand. I regarded it as a duty. I am a stoic in these matters. I don't care. I did what I thought I had to do, and then I moved on. All right? But you must note the irony that when a newspaper story ran, you know, about philosophical counseling, then my phone started ringing, and all the people who wouldn't give me the time of day for, I think, a really pretty good novel, suddenly were asking, where's the book? You know, well, agents who wouldn't give me the time of day were now asking me out to lunch. Publishers who wouldn't have let me into their offices were now trying to make appointments. This is ironic, yes? But it also came from no striving. Or did it come from a lot of striving and then no striving? See, what did it come from? It's a philosophical question, yeah?
I was wondering if you could share some of the options as to the process of becoming a philosophical counselor, particularly if your person has an MA. Are there different routes to follow? Is it through your organization? Are there other organizations? What do you do?
Okay, good. Finally, a practical question, one I can answer in 30 seconds or less. Yes. Right now, the American Philosophical Practitioners Association, which is the one I'm more or less running with my colleagues, is the only one that has the, shall we say, the foresight or perhaps the chutzpah to certify people. You know, there's always a first generation. We grandfathered ourselves in, we certified ourselves, and now we're training and certifying others. People tend to think, you know, there is somewhat of a backlash to this, or sometimes a very good winnowing, you know, by creative, constructive, intelligent criticism. People say, well, how can you be doing this? And we remind them, look, you know, there's some preconception in the culture that in the Garden of Eden there was Adam, Eve, a serpent, and a psychologist. You know, they think that psychologists were somehow created on another day. But this wasn't the case. There was a first generation of professionals in every profession who, by virtue of being the first, had to declare themselves to be what they were, convince people that they were professional and reputable enough to be that, and then to devise ways of training the real generation that was going to do the work once the pioneers had cleared the ground. So if you have an MA or a PhD in philosophy, you have more than enough philosophical knowledge. As far as we're concerned, probably too much philosophical knowledge. And what you need to learn are the practical counseling skills that every counselor knows to understand how to develop your own scope of practice and to work with people in this way. And this is the kind of training we provide for counselors, for facilitators, for consultants across the board. I can give you a cards later, and you can look at our website if you wish, or I can have hard copies sent to you that would explain things in much more detail. But basically, anybody with philosophical expertise at the accredited graduate level can find out by virtue of taking our training whether he or she is equipped to and interested in pursuing a career in counseling. What we're finding is that many academics are coming forward, and if you want a quick example of that, the last training we did, but one, was in Los Angeles in December, and the entire faculty of the University of the Pacific came to be trained by us. The entire, meaning four, but the university, this is the full-time faculty. The University of the Pacific is California's oldest chartered university, and there were two senior analytic philosophers who obviously weren't going to do anything with this, and there were two junior people, one of whom has subsequently gone back, given a talk to the clinical psychologists at his campus's wellness center, and made enough sense to them to get referrals from them to him, and he's now sending us case studies, you know, which basically we give critiques of as part of the mentoring process. Now, why did they do this? They were evaluated. Those of you who are academics know perfectly well that there are pro forma 5-year evaluations that are done routinely of departments. Very good people come in, very often do sincere evaluations. The administration then files these for another 5 years, and that's the end of it. This time, the philosophy department was evaluated, and the recommendation was that they do something to revitalize themselves. And the administration said, we're taking this seriously, and if you really do want to revitalize yourselves, then we'll help to pay for it. That's the magic word, pay. And so they shopped around. They said, what can we do? And it didn't take them long to figure out that they could get certified. And they did. And this is basically how, by word of mouth and by other means, we're coming to train and certify people in the academy. We're also certifying, training and certifying graduate students who are, I think, quite right to regard possibilities as being open on both fronts, and they will have this as a tool if they wish to practice in addition to being teachers. This is basically how it works. We have a code of ethics, and we build them for others, right? We're professional. People pay us as consultants to build codes of ethics for them as professionals. We can't do this for ourselves. You know, we should be doing it for others. So we have all the accoutrements of a professional practice, and we're in the throes now of winning political recognition. We've won cultural recognition already. And in America, of course, the largest lobby group is the electorate. And so we're very optimistic.
Hey, I have a question. The first one is a practical aspect of your using philosophy as therapy. What do you think is, what do you or you feel it's the most difficult aspect of it when you have to use philosophy and help out another person.
That's one.
And the other aspect is the fundamental one. I think that you need a belief, a strong belief as a foundation. For example, what is the truth? What is good? What is bad? What is standard of value? So I wonder what your personal popular or what do you what philosophical school do you adhere to? Ethics, metaphysics, and epistemology.
Fair enough.
Thank you.
Fair enough. Good questions, both of them. In the first place, the greatest danger actually is that we'll succeed in professionalizing ourselves, and then we'll become as corrupt and as bureaucratized and as institutionalized as the other professions and begin to fail just as they do. So one of the things we try to avoid, for example, are long-term codependencies, which very typically emerge in other modalities. In fact, I try and get rid of my clients. This is my goal. I have other things to do. I want you to be philosophically self-sufficient. Many of us work this way. So my goal is for you to go away and be well and do what you do. I don't need to know very often what you're doing, but I need to know that you're philosophically self-sufficient. This typically doesn't take long. The problem is that we encounter people who have had a lot of psychotherapy already, some people who have had years and years of it. And so they have a certain expectation about the nature of a therapeutic encounter, and they get very good at telling their life story, but it still takes them a year or two. And we have to explain to them at the at the outset that they either have a problem we can work on immediately and perhaps resolve quickly, or they have a process-oriented issue. It could be a long-standing conflict that they want to resolve. There could be a narrative that needs to unfold over a period of months, you know, and possibly even years. I've never seen anyone for more than a year, and I don't really want to. But there is that danger, okay? You get the drift. We need to learn from the other professions and try not to fall into some of the crevasses into which they have plummeted. And your second question is much more difficult. I have certainly, an affection and a respect for certain kinds of philosophical systems over others. As there is no field of study yet called the psychology of philosophy, I cannot tell you why it is that I prefer certain philosophies to others, nor why my colleagues might prefer others. But we generally do not try to impose our views on our clients. We are working within the client's worldview system, not within ours. So the dialogue, which is the thing we're offering in counseling, in lieu of diagnosis, you understand, the dialogue unfolds in the mindscape of the client, not in the mindscape of the counselor. We are using philosophical dialogue as a vehicle for exploring the client's worldview, because if you have beliefs that aren't working for you, then we need either to tinker with your beliefs or perhaps indeed to replace them. But in the first instance, I will not say to you, well, no, you shouldn't believe in philosopher X because really philosopher Y is much better. That's not at all what we do. Sometimes we simply don't ever mention any philosopher's names at all. It's the media that has encouraged us to do this. Sometimes just having a philosophical conversation is enough. And if you're talking to a philosopher, you know that the conversation is sooner or later going to wax philosophical. If you came into my office with a very complicated problem and I listened for 10 minutes and I said, Nietzsche, would you feel better? Or I said, no, you don't look better. Plato, you feel better now? No, of course not, because we're not doing sympathetic magic, and the pronouncement of names is not really the issue, nor is the imposition of our own views. That in itself is trickier, and since you've asked the question, you probably already know the answer, that it's somewhat impossible to be completely value neutral, and therefore impossible not to impose one's views or not to incline toward one system or another, but that's okay. We're entitled to our preferences. I mean, that's just the point. And this is why it's a kind of an art form, and partly incumbent on the client to find a philosophical counselor with whom he or she enjoys working, and that may be because they share similar views. So it's a journey, and you're not going to get the same thing. None of us is at this moment going to shoehorn a client into a particular box, and none of us as counselors comes out of the same mold either, and that is what makes it interesting.
But what is your personal belief?
Well, I will answer you in a sort of circuitous way. In a novel that I have yet to publish, I have a character who declares what my personal belief is. It is that I believe what I doubt, and I doubt what I believe. Actually, if you want to know what I find to be the most refreshing or useful or in some way, I suppose, perennially wonderful philosophical systems, I tend to find decision theory very good. It's an underdeveloped field of philosophy anyway because it's a branch of mathematics that philosophers have got hold of but haven't done that much with. It's very fruitful because people need to make decisions all the time and are always looking for good tools to help them. So decision theory is good. I like very much Chinese philosophy. Because I find it to be sublime and almost always applicable if people are intuitive and receptive to it. But I mean, in my book, there are about 60 philosophers that, you know, that I would make use of on a more or less regular basis. My favorites, I don't know. How's that? I don't know. Am I allowed to be a philosopher too? Socrates, no, definitely not. No, no. Socrates actually helped people to discover contradictions in their belief systems, but he was not a practitioner in the sense that we are. He gave people more problems than they had to begin with. And this is not quite the idea of counseling. Yes?
I must admit, I'm still a little bit confused as to the actual practical application of philosophical counseling on an individual basis.
Mm-hmm.
Building ethics systems for companies, yes, but what sort of problems do you deal with for individual people? Do they come to you for the same sort of thing as they would go to a psychotherapist? I can't talk to my mother, I'm afraid of mm-hmm. commitment, that kind of thing?
Sometimes.
Or is it...
Well,
I'm not sure.
Were you here for the other case that I cited?
The
case of the guy who had to take the painting down. Well, if you understood this, he had negative emotions, which were not doing him any good, but these emotions themselves were not the root cause of his problem, which I maintain lies in a philosophical domain. So what you say is true, or what you imply is quite right in my experience and that of my colleagues. It turns out that the human being has certain sorts of manifestations which could be viewed either psychologically or philosophically, and sometimes a person can benefit from both. For example, if you have a question about your identity. Of course, the literature of psychology is very rich in this area, and you could spend a lot of time doing various kinds of psychological investigations of the question of your identity, right? If you're having what we call an identity crisis, you can find a plethora of psychological advice, but you can also find an equally interesting amount of philosophical advice on the topic, because identity is something that philosophers have looked at too. So then the question becomes, which do you want to start with, or which do you want to end with? And it turns out that there are a lot of different questions that pertain to selfhood. For example, the self, a little bit related to identity. This is a subject that psychology addresses, also philosophy. If psychologists are worried about self-esteem, philosophers are worried about worthiness, and we treat that very differently, but not inefficaciously, you see? If you want to resolve a conflict, be it on the job or be it in the family, well, you can look at the psychology of conflict, but there is a very vast and helpful literature on the philosophy of conflict too. So we are offering an alternative. And not, it's not for everyone, and it's not an elitist thing. Some people are, I've devised a euphemism, people who aren't ready for this are pre-philosophical. So that's fine. The people who are pre-philosophical will be happy with other modalities, but some are not. And in point of fact, we see lots of people who have had already a certain amount of psychotherapy, and it's done something for them, and they've learned something about themselves, but that's not the end for them. They want to discover who they are philosophically as well as psychologically. Does that make sense to you?
It helps, thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. I have explicit cases in the book. I'm not trying to sell this to you. It just happens to be that the book has lots of explicit cases which try to show how philosophy is used distinctly. Yes?
It has been proven that the state of mind and the attitude will help people heal their bodies. Mm-hmm. In hospitals, in cancer centers, they have people working with them to help them. What role would you see philosophical counseling playing in the healing and hospitals dealing with the sick people?
What a wonderful question, and one that certainly offers many potential answers at this point. Look, we as medical ethicists have gone in and done the other thing. You know, we've discussed the ethics of pulling the plug, you know, the ethics of turning off the respirator, the ethics of abortion, the ethics of euthanasia, all of the necrophilic things. But as far as the biophilic things are concerned, we haven't done much yet. It is true, I have read these studies, and I am also convinced surgeons, you know, for a long time have talked about the will to live. Yes, that's one of the old school things we hear about. The will to live still doesn't show up on an MRI. I don't believe it's detectable by positron tomography either, or by dissection of the brain. But we recognize it as an effective causal agent. People who statistically are in similar situations, who differ in that one has the will to recover and the other doesn't, will differ in their prognoses for that reason. So what can we do? We can, first of all, learn how this thing that we call the will is efficacious in these settings, and then we can attempt to see what kinds of philosophical systems support visualization, for example, very close to Tibetan yogas, basically, where questions threshold of discovering. But certainly giving people reasons to live is one way, perhaps, in mobilizing their wills. So like you, I think there's a lot that can be done. This is what you're implying. And it's, again, a matter for exploration and empirical research. Practice is an empirical thing. We're not going to figure it out by being armchair metaphysics. We have to go into the field and try things out. But I share your view. Thank you.
The kind of issue that I have is that I, coming out of our philosophy, find that when you talk about practical kinds of issues in that in fact come out of this area, what you are saying is no doubt absolutely true, because people in the area no doubt handle these kinds of things. But it also appears to me that what you are dealing with is an area that is much, much broader. And the issue that I then face is that when you in fact have these people working out their practical issues by turning to these thinkers, are you not giving them a kind of false vision of what in fact these thinkers are actually handling? That becomes the first problem. Mm-hmm. The other problem that I face is that insofar as what you want to do is you want to give people answers and visions, I wonder in fact why one only has to turn to people like Hegel and Hume, and why, for example, there are any number of how-to books on the market, any number of religious books which also deal with the same kind of issues. Why concentrate just on this particular area?
All right, the second question first. Because, again, we have moved into a secularized society, people who have religious beliefs, who belong to religious communities, don't need this and often don't want it, although by the same token we get lots of calls these days from pastoral counselors who are also looking for philosophical tools. Remember, of course, theology and philosophy ran a long way together. In fact, philosophy was subsumed under theology for a long time, and we get requests for certification from pastoral counselors or theologians whose philosophical training stopped circa 1600, so they have a few centuries of catching up to do, but basically they do have good understanding of Augustine, of Aquinas, and so forth, of Neoplatonism, but they've missed out on a fair bit of modern philosophy. Now, the thing is that people don't need this, and we're not forcing anybody to do it. I mean, it's clear that there's a need out there, as I earlier said, which is not being met by traditional modalities, and that's what people are looking for. We're not saying this is what you should do. We're merely saying here we are, and if you want this, then you can avail yourself of it. Try it. If you prefer Prozac, then good. If this works for you, good. Sometimes you may want both. Sometimes you may want neither. This is your decision. We're really Kantians in the sense that we attribute to you autonomy. You do what you like. But we're also empiricists in that we say, the thing that worked for you last year might not work this year, in which case you have to contemplate change and the nature of change and the philosophy of change, too. And who better to do that with than a philosopher? As to the first question, yeah, it can get very superficial in America. I tried to avoid this problem and found that I couldn't. I did a lot of radio, and I still do, in which there's open line philosophical counseling, and people would phone in, and this was refreshing to them. So they would phone in, instead of talking to a psychologist or Dr. Laura or somebody, instead of making it political, so they could talk to a philosopher. They found this intriguing, and the switchboard lights up when we do this kind of thing. People would phone in, and we would have a conversation. That they would have 30 seconds to state their problem, and I would have perhaps 30 seconds to give them some kind of philosophical analysis, and that would be it. And yes, so American media driven circus type of events are the antithesis of the reflection and the meditative life that we also need to lead to be philosophical, if only for ourselves, but also for others, true. But then the question is a little bit still better than none? If you're going to drink whiskey straight, fine, but if you have to take some water, you can dilute it and still presumably enjoy the whiskey. So I'm not apologizing for this exactly. I'm merely saying that when I tried to boil everything down to the one-minute radio encounter, this was not good enough, because the DJ or the host would dig me in the ribs and say, but Lou, what's the name of the philosopher who said this, But Lou, they needed a benediction. They were actually behaving as though they were being theologically conditioned. And I wanted to say, but damn it, I'm the philosopher who happened to say this time. I may be quoting somebody else another time. If Hobbes said this, I'll say Hobbes said it. If de Beauvoir said this, then I'll happily credit her. But sometimes I even say things, and so I'm willing to say, well, this is what I think, but that's not good enough because I'm alive. They need somebody dead, okay? So just to make it sound like a real benediction, this has to be a dead philosopher. So they're really saying, Lou, you know, you listen to the problem and then you think up the name of the dead philosopher that, you know, will make the person feel better. This is the problem, yes, that we need to avoid. And the media has really invented us or reinvented us, because most of my colleagues and I never worked like this. We would talk to people without ever naming a philosopher. We were the philosophers, and we had the access to philosophical systems and insights which don't have to be named to be understood, and which the clients didn't come to have named. If they wanted the names of philosophers, they would take the history of philosophy, and they would get the names. So it became difficult, and it's still a struggle for us. But the book's treatment is, I would not say exactly superficial, but it's geared to the self-help market, which is the largest. This is what I had nothing to do with, and where the publisher took over and made it what it is. It's the self-help market, believe it or not, is the largest market for books. And more people buy self-help books in America than any other kind of book. And this was the kind of book the publisher wanted to make it into. And I didn't oppose them. There's enough philosophy in there. You should also remember that if you're a philosopher, a lot of this will seem trivial to you, but that's because you know much more. For people who manage to avoid philosophy courses, it's going to look like a lot at first blush. So remember your own perspective. What may be simple to you is simple because you know the thing. But for the person who hasn't encountered it before, it could be also relatively complex. Yes?
I think maybe there's one gentleman there.
Okay, one more? We'll try and make it short. Okay.
I really have no questions. I just want to say my name is Lou, and I want to commend you. I want to commend you very much for your approach here and for trying to help people without implying to them that they have to be sick, you know, to be helped. A lot of people can be helped without even using that term therapy. I come from both a psychological background of psychology and a background of engineering, and I would say my engineering background has trained me to try and be more pragmatic and to apply things and to make things simpler so that people can use them in everyday life. And I like your approach. I would say one of the things that we learned very early in our psychology training was that you can help a person change by changing their thinking, by changing their feeling, by changing their behavior. There are many other ways too. But it seems to me that your approach with philosophy is to change their thinking. Many times a person finds themselves in a situation, and this perhaps addresses the question asked by that lady, how does a philosophical counseling help an individual? All you have to do is help a person change their thinking. Many times, like this example you gave us of this individual with the painting, you know, his seems to me that his interest was to get his painting up there, get a painting up there, and get some recognition for the work that he was doing, instead of taking it as a personal offense and, you know, feeling hurt and then thinking of other ways to get back at the director of the gallery, whoever it was who made the decision to compel him to take his painting down. And you showed him a way to get what he wanted by just changing his approach. The only question I have for you here, and it's not a question of your approach at all, I'm wondering if you heard of Paul Watzlawick. Paul Watzlawick, I think he's still alive. He wrote two books, and I know he had a PhD in psychology, and he was teaching at some U.S. university. And he wrote two books that I remember. One of them was called Change, and the other one was called Reframing. And basically what that did was show a person who's beset with a certain personal problem that there's usually another way of looking at it. As long as you can change a person's perspective and they see that they have a choice, and the more choices they have, the freer a person becomes, and the person becomes empowered themselves. And with a repetition of that, they start to feel that they themselves can solve their problems, and they usually can see their way out of situations that seem to them as, you know, they're really in a closed-ended system. And I want to thank you again very much for your presentation.
Thank you indeed. Thank you very much.
I'd like to ask Ron Perrone from the class of 1968, our director of advancement, to give thanks tonight. Ron.
Lou, Louie, I didn't hear Louise. Not many of you know how outstanding an athlete Louis Marinoff is. And he certainly was, and I had the privilege of playing with him, of being a teammate when we won the city hockey championship. We had one rule with the hockey team, and that was no back-checking. Because Louis that year had 8 shutouts. And so we would simply, in the opposing team zone, lose possession of the puck, and then turn around and watch. And Louis led us to our hockey championship. So in appreciation of Louis's giving and sharing tonight, we would like to present him with his own hockey sweater to take back, but not with number 1 or number 29 or number 30, because we know all great goaltenders, once they officially retire from the game, end up playing defense or forward or whatever. So we have number 6. And as this is standing room only, it reminds us of the 7th game of a Stanley Cup that I think we all do remember many years ago in Montreal. But it's number 6, Ralph Backstrom, who was reputed to be one of the greatest skaters and one of the greatest stick handlers, but also known to be able to skate around the same person several times without necessarily getting to the other goal. Louis, thank you very much for what you've done with us tonight. I do have two announcements. One is that a wallet was found, and I think, Dr. Bennett, do you have the wallet?
I've returned it.
Okay, we've returned the wallet. And the other thing is, this is a wonderful new Webster Learning Activity Center. For those of you who have not taken a look through the center, please take a few minutes to wander through, stroll, and tour, and you're most welcome to stay for a while and to come back as well. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I have to reply to Ron before we go down for the book signing and the coffee and the cookies and the chit-chat. Listen, the truth is that Ron Perrone led this team. He led a junior team that was so good that we used to beat our seniors in practice. Okay, Ron himself should have been playing for, you know, for the Montreal Canadiens, I think. But basically, they just made sure that no one took any shots on me. I stood there in goal, and their way of winning was to make sure that the puck was always at the other end of the ice so that I wouldn't have to make any saves, and that's closer to the truth.
Philosophically speaking.